What do you think of the English language, Jack, in comparison to the other languages you've had experiences with?
At this time, I don't think I have much to say about the language itself, only about how it's spoken.
That's an interesting avenue. You should talk about that. What did they speak in Guam? Was it English?
English.
How different was it from English in, say, Fayetteville?
Same. Well, pretty much same. You know, only minimal regional differences. English is generally the same everywhere.
Well, but I mean, like, not necessarily, like, actual differences in the syntax, the vocabulary of the language, but, you know, they're, like, what percentage of idioms would you say were shared between the two cultures?
Close to 100.
All right, okay.
English is remarkably the same everywhere.
I didn't know that.
I suppose, you know, you got the British half and the American half.
Oh, yeah.
But other than that, it's basically the same. Australian kind of has differences, but
all of the differences are well documented and like, or that they're like, you know, I know all of them, I'd say. We make fun of them when we make fun of Australian people, that's what we make fun of. The big differences in the language.
Yeah, most of the differences I would say you probably don't know.
Really?
Yeah. Did you know I've been to Australia?
No, I didn't.
Okay. Yeah, I was in Australia for a month.
Doing what?
Nothing in particular.
Why were you there?
A trip. Just to travel. The family went.
I feel like I should have known about that. Did you document it at all?
This was before I started. Oh. This was when I was 13. It was the winter before the cast. I believe. Yeah, that was one of the, up until then, that was about the most incredible year of the life. The most different things. You know, I'd been to 3 or 4 schools, 4 or 5 countries, moved several times, started the cast that summer. You know, finished my homeschooling at the University of Nebraska website and went to New College. Dropped out of New College, you know. What happened?
That was when you were 13?
Yeah, 13, 14.
Wow. I've never really had that much different stuff happen to me in 1 year. I don't think I've had that much different stuff happen to me throughout my entire life.
Huh.
My life's pretty stable. I guess there was the pre-drug period and the post-drug period, but those are the only major differences I could think of.
Yeah.
Did you change often, like?
Me?
Yeah.
No. I didn't.
You stayed stable?
Yeah. Yeah, my development would have happened whatever circumstances there were, pretty much. No.
Wow.
You know, what I think tends to be kind of cut off or separate from the circumstances of the regional circumstances.
Yeah. What was your childhood like, Mac? I've never asked you that.
You know, there was a particular night where I was really I was talking about it. I don't think you were there. That was with Jenny, I think. Jenny and I used to talk, you know, like how we talk. We don't talk very much anymore.
Why not?
Boyfriend.
Oh. Is he as intellectual as you are?
No. And that's what I was thinking. How does he say it? I don't know, maybe she doesn't want or need as much. I'm not sure. She's happy with sharing simple things.
Man. You visited Nicole a bit ago.
I did.
What was that like?
I was happy I did it. She, you know, I came into it with no expectations. On the, she has a page. I wrote her in on that page. People met off the internet. Smiley face next to it for the binary. And, yeah, she showed me a lot of interesting people. So that was good.
Who did you meet? I heard you didn't like Joey at all.
No. Actually, I didn't like anybody that I met.
Oh.
Yeah, I did not. I didn't like Joey, but it was really the people that she called the Goliaths, which I hated. Do you know them?
Yes.
Okay. One of them
has Asperger's and the other two are kind of ordinary people. Almost. I think that's the right group of people that I'm thinking of.
Probably. There's three or four brothers.
Yeah. Did you meet their Jewish mother?
No.
She was very irritating.
There was something going on between the mother and the father. They were sort of in a Cold War. He was talking about how they're my children too, and that the police were involved with.
What? Yeah. That sounds like a hot war to me.
A hot war? Yeah.
Whenever police get called.
Yeah. But I think what I said before was, I don't know, maybe it isn't that necessary. And we don't want to forget about the childhood thing that you asked. What do you want to hear about? Direct the conversation.
What sort of experiences in your childhood directed you to become the person that you are now? Were there any experiences, or was it just like, was it all you the entire way?
This is profound, dude. You're good.
I'm good?
Yeah. Now you ask a good question. I don't think I've ever been asked a question that good, really, you know? And the childhood is sort of a... some adjective spot for me, because it never gets brought up. It never gets thought about, really. It's, I kind of think of it as horrible.
Horrible?
Yeah. There was a lot of fear, like, everywhere.
Why?
Wait a second. Well, I'm getting ahead of the where we should be going. What experiences shaped who you are?
Or was
it
just
so?
It was a three-part question with two of them being conditional.
Yeah, I've thought about this somewhat before. And there's a...
Do you mind the smoke at all? Or?
No. I pretty much don't mind anything except behavior. What?
That was just a very Mac answer.
Yeah. It's true.
If I had my Facebook open right now, I would put that in my quotations page. Do you mind the smoke? No. I pretty much mind... Yeah.
Don't mind anything but behavior.
Don't mind anything but behavior. Experiences from your childhood.
The only solid thing I can say that I only recently discovered is that I grew up in Western civilization around this time. And but when I say around this time, I mean in terms of hundreds of years. This is the only thing I can firmly say, you know, had an influence on who I am.
All right.
Kind of. I think I'm sure of that.
If you were to be born 100 years earlier, you would.
If I were to be born several thousand years, 10,000, I'd be different. But within the hundreds of years.
You would be exactly the same person.
Yeah.
Or at least close enough.
Yeah.
The differences would never become noticeable.
And since we're talking about the childhood here, the next thing that I may offer some difference to. You know, I think I'm going to go back to one of my first sort of, I'm not sure what to call it, intellectual times. Around the time I was 13 and 14, did I tell you earlier that I was obsessed with becoming the Übermensch?
Yes, you did.
That's when that started happening. And I sort of attributed it to being, you know, I saw things deterministically then, and I still do very much now, as you know.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, there's no really environmental causality I can find to where that came from or why I continue to be, you know, so into it. You know, I write, the things that I write are, you know, very large, I guess. You know, megalomaniacal came to mind, but it's not maniacal. You know, I just about all the adventures to sea, living the most profound life possible to man, all these types of things, I don't know where they came from. Back then, I, you know, sort of a first sentence or phrase or thought, an inaugural one for my life that I can remember, is that I am a machine for something. That something has to do with this. I'm not sure. It's sort of like I know that I will chart a new course for the world, at least for anybody who wants to follow or, you know, create in that mist, who wants to utilize the type of creative platform that I would be the first one to create. But I don't know how and I don't know why. At that time, I didn't know how or why. And now this time, I can still be proud of my current self and my past selves in progress and figuring things out according to this. I know a lot more why, and I have many ideas for how, and they come frequently.
All right.
Okay, sticking to the question. Yes, the other environmental circumstance would be the travel, about being raised as a traveling person. And the virtues that my dad recommended and the things that he said to me. I remember the things that he says to me, you know, from very far back. I actually have, you know, Desiree is notes me for, you know, having a complete recording of everything she's ever said. Tape recorder. A mental recording, not a,
yeah, yeah.
You know, I forgot the word for this, you know, memory outside of yourself. There's a Wikipedia article on it.
Yeah. Much larger access time, much larger storage space.
Yes. And much more lossier. Well, I don't know. I don't, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah. Were you going to that? But we should just talk about your childhood.
Where was I? Oh, yeah. Yeah, things that he said. I've also noticed different virtues in the sense of predispositions to certain ways of thought that I don't know where they come from exactly. One of them is loyalty. Loyalty is extremely important to me, but I don't know why, and I think it's not rational. You know? Of course I'm willing to dump loyalty when it's necessary, but you know, it's pretty important. I don't know if it's a sort of extrapolation of myself into other people and expectation of how relationships should be, since I, you know, between you and I, we call me remarkably consistent or, you know, that type of thing. Do we?
Yeah.
Okay. And that face showed some skepticality.
No, I was actually nauseous.
Okay.
I'm undergoing a lot of various, very crazy sensory stuff right now.
Okay.
That is not relating to you.
Okay. But there is some stuff about, maybe most of it, I guess, that I try to trace back about who I am that I have no idea, you know, why that is. Maybe it's just the way the computer was configured from the beginning.
Ooh.
That was the idea about, you know, being a machine for it.
Right.
I'm not even sure what it is yet, but you know, I was sure that I was machined for something specific.
I don't know what that would be, but it would be some sort of good thing. I can't.
I guess you don't know about the ideas that float around my head about what to do. No. You know, with like.
Like what? What to do about what, and what ideas do you have?
Oh, what to do with, you know, the potential ways to create those creative platforms. Or, you know, sow the seeds of freedom for millions to come. I discovered early on in the same bit of thinking, I knew that it had to be something which was, I don't know, exponential, I guess. Something that created itself. Because you can't just make something, either if it's a physical thing or make a discovery. That's the least you could do. Like, if you discovered the nature of, you know, some law.
Right.
That would itself be, that's a linear thing. It'll be carried on, but it won't grow upon itself.
Right.
It's a static good in time. It doesn't change. And you have the problem of people forgetting. It's possible, no matter how soon or far in the future, that people could forget it. So you've got to make something that cannot be forgotten. So I don't know. I don't know what that is yet.
And that's only if you want this linear accomplishment.
No. I guess you could make a linear accomplishment that would not be forgotten, but that's on the fringes of possibility. I think real close, just by being linear, that property really puts it at something that's forgettable.
Right. But things that grow exponentially. My brain is having trouble. They last a long time. What sort of things have you thought about? Things that can grow exponentially like that.
Did I tell you about the time when? I don't think I did. Yeah.
Well, real quickly, can we clarify? What sort of ideas in the past do you think people have, or things that have been constructed, that you think were exponential, that past people have made? Are we talking like the original foundations of logic laid down by Greek philosophers? Like, would you consider that to be an idea that grows like that?
No.
No? That's linear?
That's kind of similar to the DNA thing. Like, it's something which is remembered by a small fraction of people living. And that's passed on among that small fraction to the next small fraction, who are basically the same people. It's almost like a cult, you know?
Yeah.
The people that, at a young age, say, I will become a philosopher, and they go to philosophy school, and they wear the robes, and they get the degree, and then they write they write to each other in some foreign language of philosophy. That's not the same thing. And I know people, you know, some people say that whatever the intellectual air of the time is how the people will live. Because whatever ideas the intellectuals will come up with will trickle down and influence the way that everybody thinks. I'm not sure about that.
Yeah, that sounds a little hokey to me.
I know that Thomas Sowell believes that. He's written books about that. Ayn Rand believes that. She's written books about that. There's no causality. For me, if you want to say something causes something, clearly explaining the causality is really important about what this causes this, and every other thing that, you know, goes into the system, and what their degrees are, how they influence not only this but each other,
right?
So that you have all the feedbacks, the positive and negative feedbacks, covered. And this is, you know, the big problem I have with basically anybody claiming to know truth about a complex system. without talking about how approximated things are. You know, and climate. Of course, climate in general, but one of the biggest things is that you just see these graphs. There's these line graphs, and they never show the margin of error. Without that margin of error, it's practically meaningless.
Yeah.
And they show, oh, it's going up. But in virtually all the times, it is going up, but it's still within the margin of error.
Yeah.
And they write the algorithms expecting it to go up. So that's why the margin of error doesn't really change. But, you know, but anyway, that. I'll have to think about examples of exponentiating ideas. Not sure. I think maybe people that lived thousands of years ago that people still talk about on a daily basis today might have created those exponentiating ideas.
Like who?
And it isn't even necessary that they were a single person, because I don't know how that works. You know, I mean, you've got the prophets, you've got the Buddha, and you've got Jesus and all these other people. And somehow these ideas were created and compiled. Oh,
yeah. Religion is a very exponential mark upon the world. I never thought about looking at it like that, like from the other way around, though. Like, ideas that are exponential become religious, maybe. Maybe all this, I don't know. I was thinking more along the lines.
That's possible. I think that occurs because the people that hold the idea, it's think of it as, you know, we've got a group of your friends that could all fit in this garage, and we come here and we talk about this idea, or this set of ideas, which becomes set in stone as an ideology. Because we're the only people that know about it, and because we think it's really important, and because other people, nobody else, you know, has come up with this idea, pretty much. You know, maybe there's flecks of it in people's minds, but they don't know what to do with it.
Right.
This, as the idea bounces around between each of these people, it sort of snowballs. And it goes from being completely reasonable to, as it's traded through this room only, it starts getting mystical or religious. Or why would you even ask about something?
Yeah.
As a response, why would you even ask? You can't question, you know, Ayn Rand or whatever. It's when you have small groups of people that come up with unique ideas that they think are really important, cults form.
And then the cults that happen to have the memes that happen to have a little factor built into them where they reproduce are the ones that turn into religions.
Well, the religions seem to have memes that give you a sense of self-esteem and morality. And that morality is not morality for the sake of morality as much as it is for self-esteem. When you get an idea,
I would...
Disagree?
I thought that you were going to say control. Morality for the sake of control.
No.
That seems what religion has been in my life, but...
It can... I don't think... I know that some people think that everything is for reasons of control of people by other people, but I think that really...
Are you relooking?
Yeah. The system exists... The people on top, even if you have, whether it's a ruler or a figurehead for actual rulers, I don't think anybody actually knows. Let's take a slightly different route of this one. I've become nothing.
The LSD fell out of the ice maker when I poured ice in my glass. That could have been very, very bad.
Okay.
My bad.
What was that? let's think of the question why, or the answer to why, as an abstraction.
All right.
When you describe a system which... Is this for me?
Sure. It's communal water.
When you describe a system of... I don't even need to say of what.
Yeah.
Just a system... You look at the rules of a system, and you look at how the things interact in the system, you know, over time with each other, whatever, you know, their relationships. These things are according to the rules. And to ask why is to expect a purpose, and that purpose means you have some sort of free, you know, some free entity which is choosing and making the system according to what he wants. And regardless of your belief in if humans are free or determined, any part on the spectrum or anything, I think the answer is still that the system is operating, and the rulers are part of the system. They don't create the rules on the level that we're talking about. We're talking about looking at it from the top down.
Right.
If you're in it, they're creating the rules. But looking at the top down, looking at from the top, you know, from the third dimension to the second dimension, these ideas and the people that hold the ideas, the hosts,
right?
They're just operating according to according to the ideas. I don't think that the rulers actually control, I guess. The rulers are just as controlled by the ideas as everybody else. Maybe every once in a while somebody comes along and they realize that if they change the rule they can get something out of it. But that's just called corruption. They usually just want money, or they just want, you know, sex slaves or something. It's not something that's a big deal. It's relatively small. It's not like this cult of people that passes through time that all realize that, okay, we create religion, we can get them to do whatever they want and make us infinitely rich. You know, the best possible... Is this still recording? Yeah. The best possible argument for that happening has to do with the Federal Reserves, but I don't really know what happens there.
The Federal Reserves, how does that work?
Well, you do know about Federal Reserve conspiracies, don't you?
No, I don't.
Okay. A lot of the time, I just assume that we have a completely common body of knowledge, kind of. And we do, for the most part.
Yeah.
By far more than anybody else I've ever met. We know a lot of the same things. But I guess we, with the lockpicking...
Yeah, this is the second thing.
Yeah,
I was just thinking of that.
Okay. Do you know nothing about
the Federal Reserve, no. I mean...
Okay.
More than... I mean...
I guess so.
But,
okay.
I know exactly what you would expect someone who knows what I know to know.
Okay. How do I explain this? I'll explain it in the most... sort of rationally probable explanation of what could be happening.
Okay.
Because all this stuff is secret, so we don't know. And that's something that happens with conspiracies. Something weird happens, and you come up with all these explanations for why it happened. But you don't know which one it is, or if you even... Or it could have just been some occurrence that wasn't intended.
They all have great explanatory value and very little evidential value. That's the nature of conspiracy theories.
So I guess I'm going to explain the one that has the best explanatory value without going too far.
All right.
I guess. You know, saying the conspiracy, but without adding on extra ideas about how they're secretly raptors and, yeah. You know.
Right.
Let's see, right now I'm not fully conscious of it, so I'm just going to go ahead and start talking and see what comes out.
Okay.
The idea is... Do you know how money got started?
You mean
in a theoretical sense?
You mean currency, like
yeah, currency.
Anthropological. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. We go from gold certificates or precious metal certificates to money. Okay. To currency.
Okay, we're talking about that particular paradigm shift, because there was the shift from actual men, you know, actual precious
okay.
metals to.
Yeah, that was the shift, which I was assuming the background knowledge. Did
right,
I explain
yes,
that?
Yeah. No.
Okay.
Good on that.
So we go from people's banks of precious metals issuing paper currency in certificate form to what's called the sort of fiat and central banking system. With this, I don't know, maybe I should just explain a one-sentence basic idea of the whole thing instead of explaining everything necessary. And maybe I don't remember a lot of the things. I did read about this a lot at one time.
All right.
I guess the idea is all of the banks that normal people go to are all basically the same bank on a higher level. And because each of those banks are really just branches of the central bank of the nation. And in this case, the U.S. has a pretty, you know, influential and the biggest central bank.
Right.
And the central bank creates monetary policy for the country. The central bank is extremely secretive. The central bank is, by a reasonably strict interpretation of the Constitution, completely unconstitutional.
All right.
Do you know about that?
Yeah.
Okay. Because you know, Congress is supposed to coin money and this type of things, but they're...
There were some pretty discreet things said about how money worked in the Constitution. They're being violated by the Federal Reserve?
There is not much said about how money works, only that Congress is supposed to make it. The part where people say it's unconstitutional is that what Congress has done is they actually created what's called a quasi-governmental agency, and people that believe in the conspiracy called it a private company. But according to the government, it's a quasi-governmental institution. It's sort of, you know, half... It's private in the sense of keeping secrets, but it's also run by the government. But it doesn't have... There's no sort of oversight by any other part of the government.
That sounds so... That sounds like a cesspool for evil.
Yeah, that's why I'm saying this is the most reasonable, you know, sort of cult that goes passed on through history, that they know they create the rules and they can get anything they want out of it.
Right.
But, yeah, so it is 100% secret. It's held as completely legitimate by pretty much everybody in the government and most people that just don't know about it. The thing that they can do is they create money and they remove money.
Sally Greenspan's stuff.
Yes. Although today Ben Bernanke is
oh,
the chairman.
Yeah.
And these guys are I don't remember if they're elected or I think they're like half elected, half appointed. I think the system is like a sort of a hybrid between them. But each state has its own central bank. Not each state, actually. There's five of them, I think. And, you know, there's one in New York, one in Denver, one in Philadelphia, one in Chicago. Sort of big cities. And they each have a board.
Maybe one in Miami?
Maybe. I don't know.
That sounds right to me.
Okay.
Continue.
They have a board of people there that are elected, I think. I mean...
Elected by who?
The reason why I'm saying elected, appointed, is because they're elected by past board members. You know?
Alright.
And,
Why would a system like that ever be created by a sane individual?
It wouldn't.
Like,
that, and like I was telling Kim about this when we were watching DC the first day, and this was one of the, like, she is missing the common body of knowledge that we have.
All right.
And one of these things had to do with gold and central banking and things. And I was just, over and over again, I was shocked that she didn't know things, but I was trying to be like, you know, because if you're outwardly shocked that I can't believe you don't, that's not very good for the other person. That's
right.
That's what I'm going to put down. But, so I started, once she was telling me she was serious and she wasn't just messing with me, then I started, you know, holding back and just going out to explain what it is. But I was telling her how people in Congress, you know, early on, would beat each other, you know, within an inch of their life, and people would shoot each other over it. They thought it was extremely important that the nation's currency be backed by gold, back a very long time ago. You know, these are congressmen. This doesn't happen in Congress today.
Right.
They don't threaten each other's lives in Congress for voting on, you know, creating a central bank or whatever. And she couldn't believe that happened. And, you know, it's sort of a big deal. That's why you...
Well, yeah, when you have a gold-backed economy, it all comes back to something.
Yes.
So when there's nothing, it's...
It goes back to the board. Whatever they decided. They can put money wherever they want to. They can take it from wherever they want to. They control the rate at which it grows. And they control... how the overall supply around the world. So you can see why there is a lot of power. Some people say that this is actually the most powerful position in the world, rather than what normally people would say the president has the most power of any individual person.
Right.
So that this is sort of the intro to the conspiracy. And it is fertile ground for conspiracies to happen.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
And by a basic definition of conspiracy, it is a conspiracy. You have a group of people secretly conspiring to commit acts on other people. So of course it's a conspiracy, but is it a conspiracy in the sense of, you know, your wildest dreams?
I don't know.
The next level up in believability is, you know, this is sort of the ground.
Yeah.
This is
all we have here is documents.
This is what's true.
Yeah.
The next level up is not that far of an expectation. I only started to believe it this summer. That it was possible. Before I believed that there is actually a point where you would not want more money. You know, what can you do with $9 billion that I can't do with $6 billion or whatever? We're talking about billions here.
Right.
No, that's 1,000 more than a million.
Yeah.
I mean, 1,000 times a million.
Yeah.
For every million you have... $100 million. Yeah, this is the difference between a gigabyte and a petabyte.
They're both enormous, and one is much more enormous than the other.
Exactly. And, but this guy was saying, you know, I mean, it sort of made me realize... That, yeah, I mean, I'd want $9 billion over $6
billion. Yeah.
I could, you can have anything you want in terms of material. And you can fake, or any, if we want to get, you know, philosophical, you can fake spirit to other people.
Yeah.
Spirit has, you know, the value of yourself. But, you know... Get more islands, you can buy an airport, you can buy anything you want. You can have anything you want. Just by siphoning off a very small amount of money compared to what goes in and out of that place.
So, right now we're talking about individuals who are in powerful positions in the Federal Reserve doing things that are specifically for their own individual gain.
Yes.
Okay.
And I would imagine, here's the paradigm of selfishness and altruism.
All right.
That anything bad they do, the worst things that they do, are... I'm not...
How are we going to define bad? Having a larger effect on things than they should?
Doesn't matter. We'll get there in a minute.
All right.
It doesn't matter also if, you know, Bernanke, which a lot of people don't like now that know about it, is doing this now. But just the fact that this has been going on for hundreds of years, something bad has happened before.
Right.
There has been some misuse of power to do something that's either morally wrong, you know, unconstitutional, legally wrong, or wrong in any sense. Something has happened. And this doesn't just occur in the United States, you know, you got one in Britain, you got one in, you know.
Yeah.
But what I was going to say was, altruism versus selfishness, the worst things always happen due to altruism. When you do something because of some idea which you believe is higher than yourself, you're willing to do anything for it. People are willing to die for these things. But they're willing to kill other people for these things.
I could see, because, like, if Bernanke just wanted his own mansion, that would be, you know...
Yeah, he would probably stop eventually.
Yeah. Or, like, if he just wanted to, you know, he could satisfy all of his indulgences for the rest of his life by siphoning off a practically zero amount of money.
Yes. And if he wanted to, all of his descendants and indulgences and all of his, you know, girlfriends or what, I don't know.
But if we're talking about things that... You know, then that would be the selfish, but
yeah.
From an altruistic level, he could actually do some real damage.
It goes way farther.
Yeah.
And, you know, he could do good things, too, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. But it's all random as to whether he has good ideas or not. Like,
and at a moral level, depending on, you know, what philosophy you hold, he could be wrong from the beginning that he's even touching other people's money, or money itself. But that kind of destroys itself because they own the money. People don't own the money at all. It also is owned by the Federal Reserve on every bill.
Right.
You cannot destroy this because somebody else owns it. It's, you know, each dollar is a promise to pay other dollars to them.
Yeah.
But by the fact...
I remember specifically when Cody got his passport, he came to me outraged and said that he couldn't destroy this.
Yeah.
It was owned by the government.
You can't destroy your social security card.
Yeah, and I was
like,
and I took out a $1 bill and I was like, look at this, Cody, it's the same fucking thing. You can't destroy it.
Lime cash. You know about that?
Did anything ever, like...
No.
Right.
Not that I know of.
It would have been interesting.
Yeah, that would have been awesome, but... Yeah, no, normally how it's introduced, this whole idea... You know, sort of from the bottom up with a theoretical standpoint. And what I did was the opposite way, talking about what actually happens. But it's saying that each bill you get is a promise to pay. But the fact is, you pay them in more bills. So you never pay them. And in fact, the amount that you owe to them increases over time. It increases exponentially over time.
It's a recursive function.
Yeah.
That's not necessarily exponential, but it's...
In this case, it's exponential.
Oh, all right.
Because normally, it depends on the amount that each lowest bank, or any bank under the central bank, is willing to lend out. There's a ratio that has pretty much always been locked around a 9-to-1 ratio.
Of money, M2 to M1.
Yeah. They loan out 9 times more bills than they have bills. And this is designed so that, you know, the economy can grow infinitely or whatever. But there's also artificial growth. You know,
this seems so hokey. I can't believe that it actually exists in reality.
That's traced back to the money itself and not actually any product.
Right.
And I read a quote, and this is... Awesome, what time is it? Okay, it's getting to be 9 soon.
I was thinking about that.
I read a quote by the guy that designed the EU currency system that was a lot like when you're talking about the trees and that we're people that, you know, we're slaves to the trees.
Yeah.
He said that people don't... What people want is the money. They want to accumulate money. It's not that the focus is on getting more goods or more ideas to be discovered, but they want more money itself. It was something to do with that. It was said better than what I said.
Right.
And that, it was kind of that flip around of how you see things.
Yeah.
That was really like, wow, you know?
That's crazy.
The money is supposed to be just a tool for, you know, getting real things or having real relationships.
It's supposed to be like, this is a way to make the exchange of goods easier.
Yes.
By having one good that's has any, you know, it's documented value against other goods.
And everybody, you know, a lot of people that are sort of in my sphere of where I get information are, I see things that have to do with, sort of like the same people that watch and create commercials for buying gold. You know, they want to hedge against inflation, and they worry about the economy of the world collapsing.
Do you know specifically about Glenn Beck and his gold stuff?
I know stuff about it.
It's kind of interesting, but
I know he was the spokesperson for Goldline, and he believes in buying gold. That's due to those Mormon values, really.
He bought a lot of gold about 9 years ago. That's when he believed in gold.
Yeah? He doesn't believe in it anymore?
Oh, no.
Why?
Because he's selling it all. He's selling it all right now.
Yeah. How do you know this?
It's documented. Most of the companies that have commercials for buying gold on his TV show are owned by him.
What do you mean owned by him?
Like, in different, you know, control
systems. There's some ownership.
Yeah. Like, he has a controlling interest, or at least some sort of...
Okay.
And he is basically getting people to buy his gold for more money than he bought it for. And he's advertising it as being a safe investment.
Mm-hmm.
He's literally abusing his political power over the masses to reap this incredible financial gain.
I wonder how incredible that gain is. I mean, I'm imagining a pretty small gain. So selling, buying and selling gold does not get you a large profit margin.
Have you watched Glenn Beck? And like, he is selling his gold at rates that are much different from what gold is actually worth.
Okay.
Because he's also selling it with like, it's like a kit, right? You spend $100, you get $70 worth of gold and an instructional DVD on how to be a libertarian or some bullshit, I don't know. Anyway, you were saying...
Yeah, actually, what was I saying?
I can't remember.
I don't remember anymore.
Gold. There's something about gold.
It was before that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, the people that worry about inflation and the collapse of the economy. Actually, Paul Rosenberg wrote a crazy piece on this about what could happen. Like, what would be the worst possible scenario?
I love worst possible scenarios.
After you know, an economic collapse. He called it the reverse economy. And I can't remember what was in it. Actually, I know how to get it. I could read it out, but... You know, this is... He wrote what the 1984 scenario of today. What would happen that you could not come back from? How to end the things that end dark ages and times of human decline?
Right.
How just to get rid of that sort of thing?
Yeah.
But I've taken another avenue up in this avenue. What would happen if the money, overinflated, hyperinflated, or if we just decided to get rid of it, or whatever, I don't know. I don't think things would be that bad.
I don't think things would be that different.
That's what I mean, things wouldn't be that different. Basically what would happen is we get rid of all the money, they would print new money, and give it to the people that had the old money.
Yeah.
In the case of, your bourgeois individuals, they get their check from the government in the new money, and we're starting over. And then the same system will continue.
Right.
Unless...
We get it.
And I would really like to see this happen in my lifetime. Unless people start getting violent about things. And when I say violent, I mean they're willing to be violent. Not necessarily that they are violent. But when people will start saying, did you read on Facebook
yes.
recently about the cops raiding the barbershop? Because people say, you know, it's the government, the rulers do, but the people do it to themselves.
Yeah.
The, those are actual people that are wearing those police uniforms, and they're arresting people for selling, they're arresting the Amish farmers for selling raw milk, they're arresting barbers for cutting hair without a license. In Louisiana, they arrest people for selling flowers without a license. And there's a pretty, this summer, there was a little girl selling lemonade out in front of an art museum or something, and the police came by and ordered her to shut down her business because she was not licensed. But these are actual people doing these things to other people. What has to be destroyed is a sense of legitimacy. Or at least there has to be some cap on what you think the state is allowed to do to other people. And that cap does not exist today.
Would you like some water of your own? Or?
No, I'm fine. I don't need it.
Alright.
Can I use this toilet?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, read the just read it.
Yeah.
Alright. Okay.